Morning worship service of Trinity on the Hill United Methodist Church. We welcome you as we worship the Lord together.
Thank you. That was the two Andrews, Andrew and Andy. We're glad that you're here today to help us in our worship service. Welcome home. I don't think you're really convinced of that. Welcome home. Excellent. Glad that you are here today. The world is finished with Christmas, but the church is not. That's why you see our Christmas decorations still up, because this is the first Sunday of Christmas as we continue to shout the good news that Christ is born to save this world from their sin. We're glad that you're here today. I want to remind the children that we'll have a children's message, but we will not have children's church. We call this the fifth Sunday, Parenting in the Pew. So you get to have them back as soon as Greg is finished with them today. Greg and I are swapping seats today, so I'm a little rusty at what I'm doing, and he's not. Isn't that interesting? It's a wonder. It's a wonder. So we don't have an introit because a lot of our staff is on vacation. The choir's having a break. They're out there with you. You'll hear someone singing very melodiously. They're a choir member, and they're probably going to turn around and recruit you if you're singing well as today as well. So let us begin with our call to worship. Greg is going to come and lead us in that as we begin our worship service.
Let us stand for our call to worship. If it's comfortable for you to do so, you'll find it in your order of worship. This comes from the Message. It's the scripture that we're looking at today, a little different version. He, Jesus, was in the world. The world was there through him. And yet the world didn't even know us. He came to his own people, but they didn't want him. But whoever did want him, who believed he was who he claimed and would do what he said, he made to be their true selves, their child of God selves. Our hymn of praise, Go Tell It on the Mountain, number 251.
Oh,
Let us remain together, remain standing as we tell it through the Apostles' Creed, our affirmation of faith. It's printed in your bulletins this morning. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we come time to our prayers, we always go before God as a community of faith, lifting up prayers led by the pastors. Your altar is there in your pews, or you may come to the altar rail and pray, whichever is most comfortable for you this morning. Our prayer chorus is one of the classic carols of Christmas, "Be Near Me, Lord Jesus." Gracious and holy God, we praise your name. For you alone are to be exalted, and your name is a splendor and a radiance above the earth. And so let those who love God praise his name this morning. Let those who are good Christian friends of God shout out the hallelujahs of Christmas. And let everyone who has breath praise the Lord. Holy God, we know that the world is pushing Christmas into the trash bins this week or storing it in bins for next Christmas. But today we pray that you would make us, your church, faithful to this Christmas message that we shouted from the rooftops on Christmas Eve. The message that Jesus is your only begotten Son, the Son of God. The message that Jesus is Emmanuel, you are with us. And the message that Jesus moved and lived and died among us, and you raised him from the dead so that the gospel of salvation and that the gospel of right living with you and others could be spoken and shared with others. But we realize, Holy Father, that we do not live Christmas well all the rest of the year, the other 51 weeks. And so we confess that we've ignored our own spiritual lives at times. We've ignored the cries of those in need around us and across the world, and we've ignored your call to service and discipleship and witness. But Holy God, you are faithful and merciful, and through your Son, Jesus Christ, you have forgiven us of our sins and promised to fill our lives with the Holy Spirit that we might live good Christian lives. Lord, today many have come with brokenness in their lives, brokenness of health, brokenness in relationships, broken promises, and we pray that your Holy Spirit would bring healing in those places. And for those who help us in our healing process, brothers and sisters in Christ, those called to the healing vocations, we pray that you would inspire them to continue their witness and their work. As we prepare for a secular new year, it is our prayer that we would prepare our souls as well, that we would dedicate our lives once again to this message of good news for all the people of the world. And as we begin a new year of political dynamics, continue to be with those whom we've elected to be there and to support us and to represent us, whether it be on our local level or state or even national level. Bring to them a new level of compassion and justice and leadership. And may we never forget to lift them up in prayer. For those who have watched over us, even in the holidays, protecting us with the emergency care, Lord, we thank you for them. And give them time to rest as well. Continue to inspire them as they are serving us both here as well as in places around the world. And, oh Lord, may we never forget to pray for our Christian brothers and sisters who are worshiping today in places that they were not able to worship Christmas openly. And even today, they're worshiping together in places that they're hoping are secret because people do not want them to worship you. Oh Lord, we pray for the persecuted church, and let them continue to be faithful and give them strength under persecution. And most holy God, we also pray for our church, Trinity on the Hill, and the United Methodist Church, that we will continue to be faithful to carry out the discipleship and witness that you have called us to do. And in this new year, may we find new levels and new ways to be your faithful servants wherever we go. And holy God, we pray now the prayer which you taught us to live and to pray through your Son, Jesus Christ. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Believe, Lord Jesus, I ask thee to save those thy forever, and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care, and fill us for heaven to live with thee there. Our hymn of faith is number 224, one of my favorite Christmas carols that usually gets sung toward the end of the season after we finished all the more familiar ones. Good Christian friends, rejoice, because we have good news to share. It's hymn number 224, As You're Able. Let us stand as we sing. Thank you. want to invite all the children to come down and meet with Pastor Greg here for our children's sermon. And for the older kids in the pews, we would like for you to turn to one another. And as you're greeting, be sure you try to fit in the words, Christ was born to save. Let us greet one another. Good morning and welcome to Trinity on the Hill United Methodist Church on this Sunday after Christmas. We are hoping and praying that this will be a day in which you once again will hear the good news that Christ was born, Christ has died, and Christ is risen from the dead. We're glad that you're joining with us, and anytime that you're here with us in the pews, we have a place for you. May God richly bless your heart and soul. Amen.
What happened? What did we just do? I mean, like last week. What? Christmas, right. It's kind of easy to just let it slide on by when we're looking at 2019 right in front of us, right? Wow, what happened? Where did it go? You know, one of the hardest things for us to do is to kind of keep that love of Jesus, especially how we felt during Christmas, in our hearts. One way we do that, you know, is we give and receive gifts, and that's important because it reminds us of the great gift that Christ gave us. I brought one of my Christmas gifts this morning, right here. No, not the Kroger bag, it's what's inside of it, yeah, right. Yeah! My brother sent me 4 cases of tennis balls. He must think I really need the practice. That's equivalent to 72 tennis balls, 3 to a can. Isn't that amazing? But you know what? I've already used this can. Took it out yesterday. And so they're used. You can see maybe a little bit of clay on them. So I will not be able to use these again. We'll have to recycle them, like give them to a teacher so they can put them on the bottom of those chairs and the things that they do with them. But it's so much fun. I mean, I kind of am glad that he gave me so many because I have more to use. But does that make my brother any less brother to me because I've already used up one of his gifts? No. Does it change anything about my love for him because I've used up one of his gifts? No. He gave this to me, of course, because he loves me, and we are brothers, and that's important to us. But he also knew that it would be something I would use. I got 8,000 steps on my Fitbit using these. However, they did not help my backhand one little bit. So I need to talk to him about that. So they were good for me, even though they're now all used up. And my brother knew that. He knew I would use them to do something that I really, really love to do. Have you used up any of your gifts yet? Yeah. But does that make the giver any less to you? No. Well, the greatest giver of all is Jesus. And he gives us the greatest gift of all. And that's his love and the fact that he came and became our Savior. Can that ever be used up? No. It cannot be used up. And that's the beauty of recognizing that he loves us so much and cares for us so much that even though we get some of those gifts that will be used for a good thing, but they're all used up, his love will never, ever be used up. So we celebrate because of Christmas Day, we can live forevermore. Amen. Let's pray. God, we are grateful to you, thankful to you that your love never ends. We're grateful for all the gifts that we received this Christmas season and the many expressions of love from our parents and our relatives and our friends. But we're very grateful that your love never ends. Your gift is constant for all of us. And we want to say thank you. Can you say thank you, Jesus? Thank you, Jesus. Amen. You can go back to your seats for Parenting in the Pew.
Thank you. Thank you, Greg. I want to say a word of thanks to so many volunteers that made Christmas Eve so special, and really all the Advent season, from those who decorated, who cleaned up the pews, who sang in the choir. You notice the choir's not here today. We gave them a break, so they're out there with you. Missions was fully operational throughout the month of December, from the Frogs to Family Promise to Gap Ministries to so many other places. We got word from some of our missionaries in other countries and how they were doing at the time. It's just been wonderful to see the church function so well. And so in the next 2 months, we're actually going to focus on what is the church. And you'll be hearing more about that this week. And then we'll start that series next Sunday. Lauren Benson joined our staff not too long ago as our Evangelism and Connect director. And she's been working with our greeters and pie captains and attendance pad recorders. Now, this morning I got so excited in the greeting, I forgot to ask you to sign the attendance pads that are located in each pew. So do that now, or else the attendance people will not have anything to do this week. So both our members and our guests, if you'll sign that. That's the way we kind of keep up with each other with three different worship services. And it helps us along the way. And if you have questions, you can fill those out as well. So Lauren wanted to do something special for our greeters, pie captains, and attendance writers, because that deals especially with how we care for people who are new to us. Now, she's taking a break today. She's off with her family, but she has a message for us on the video screen, and so let's listen to see what she says.
Good morning. My name is Lauren Benson. You may have noticed that you were greeted with a warm welcome as you came to church this morning. Those greeters are volunteers who serve once a month at the service of their choice. We would like to say thank you with the Trinity on the Hill umbrella, so our greeters can stay dry even on rainy days. If you're interested in serving, please contact me. We would love to have you on our team in 2019.
Now, the umbrellas for the greeters are in the chapel, and we have some special gifts for the attendants and pie captains as well. If you are involved in that ministry, please stand and let us say thank you for your service as well as the gifts that you're going to get. So thank you very much. There we go. Yeah. So Lauren decided to kind of redesign the umbrellas. We did this about 6 or 7 years ago. And now they're green and white with our logo on it. And when she did the video, she was concerned that it would not be raining. So that day when she did the video, it was raining. And guess what? We're going to give you the umbrella today, and it's raining. So there you go. That's a very powerful umbrella. So be careful when you take it out. Today is the last Sunday of the year. And of course, tomorrow is the end of the year, literally. And if you're one of those who use your charitable giving for your taxes, of course, you'll need to have all that in today. We have a $2.6 million budget in this church. And one of the things that makes me so happy to be a pastor here is that I never have to scold you to catch up. We seem to always catch up and be where we need to be. And with this Sunday and tomorrow, I know you'll be faithful in your commitments and in your generosity as well. And beyond the $2.6 million is more, about $250,000 in second mile giving for missions. So it's just with great joy that I give you another opportunity to be generous with the gifts that God has given to you. With that in mind, we ask our ushers to come forward as we pray together. Our gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for all the wonderful and beautiful things that come our way in this life. We thank you that you have guided us in this church, and that you have helped us reach out beyond the walls of this church, not just in our community, but around the world. So take these gifts and use our lives to the advancement of the kingdom of the Christ child, our Savior, Jesus the Christ. And all God's people said, amen. Now, I just have to say, I got to say one more thing.
Sure.
The good news is when Greg Hatfield preaches, you get to hear the Hatfield family sing. Now, when I preach, you don't get that. So it is delightful to have Aaron and Ashley with us again. Now, they sing a lot at the Three on the Hill service, but today we get to hear them here in our traditional services.
Great. It's kind of neat they let me sing with them. I appreciate that.
Sweet little Jesus boy, born in a manger, sweet little holy child, we didn't know who you didn't know you'd come to save us all, to take our sins away. Our eyes were blind, we did not see, we didn't know. Have shown us how, and we are trying. Master, you have shown us how, even when you were dying. This world treats you mean, Lord, treats me mean too. But that's how things are done down here. We didn't know it was you. Didn't know you'd come to save us all, to take our sins away.
For today's scripture reading, in honor of that, that comes from the Gospel of John, the first chapter, starting with the 9th verse. What child was that? The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, The world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. Say, I'm born of God. I'm born of God. May these words allow the Holy Spirit to so open our hearts to the teaching of God's love and mighty grace, that we may become willing disciples for him. You may be seated. There's a tragedy right in the middle of that little pericope of Scripture. Did you catch it? Maybe in the emphasis of how it was read, you may have heard it. There's a tragedy there. Something that we as Christians, believers in Christ, part of the body of Christ, we should be concerned. Did you see it? The world did not recognize him. What? In other words, what child was that? Who? And then the phrase, it comes right after that, his own did not receive him. Those two phrases just flew at me. I'd never really given a lot of thought to that. I know that John's gospel is a bit different than the other gospels when it comes to the birth of Jesus and the recount of all of that and how it's done. But those two phrases, I'd never really given a lot of thought until looking at this particular scripture for today. And now it sends shivers up my spine. Because we still have, my friends, my believers, my fellow Christian brothers and sisters, we still have a world that does not recognize him. And as we look to 2019, my purpose today is to help us get ready. Not that anything that I say from my lips, but what the Holy Spirit interprets for you to your ears. So from here to there, there's a lot going on, and I expect that. Shepherds, we celebrate shepherds that went on a fact-finding trip. Joseph had a serious change of heart, and he made a very unpopular decision to go ahead and be with Mary. Mary was a willing servant. Wise men came from great distance themselves, didn't send a representative. Angels were very, very busy. It was the greatest setup of all time. How could anyone miss it? What child was that? Well, right there in the middle, the gospel writer, John, foregoes all the circumstances of the other gospels and gets right to the heart of the matter. He's always doing that. I'm sure it's of great concern to him. I'm not saying he didn't care about the stable and shepherds and angels and all of that. John was one to get at the heart of the matter. After all, he was the only writer who brought us that encounter with Nicodemus, were the expressed words of Jesus that we hear so often. He was talking to Nicodemus when he said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." And it goes on, "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son," that we celebrate. This is the verdict. Don't you love that part? This is right before the gavel falls. This is your plight. Light has come into the world. Just got through celebrating all that. Light has come into the world. But people loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. So right there in the middle of that little pericope of Scripture, we find this tragedy. The world did not recognize him. Hasn't changed. I'm not sure what you're thinking right now with that phrase, but what I'm hoping you are thinking is, how can I help this world recognize? How can I move in a direction that will let people realize that the greatest relationship they can have, my friends, my family, those who are around me, strangers even, is that relationship with Jesus Christ? We confess our sins. Well, John brought us up to this scripture that we just read today in a very interesting way, and I think it's important to kind of recap that. So let's look at it. First of all, he teaches us in his fashion that God, Creator and Word, made all we see. Anything made was done by God, got his stamp, including light, which is the life of men. But the darkness did not comprehend the light. Dynamic disciples comprehend light. Dynamic disciples absorb the light of Jesus. Dynamic disciples want more. Fill me up, Lord. Dynamic disciples look to the opportunity everywhere to become more knowledgeable of the love of Jesus Christ. So this light has come into the world. It's been made. Everything's been made. And then John tells us, here comes John the Baptist. A little bit of time happened there. We didn't hear about that. But here comes John the Baptist. Not the light. He would tell you that. I'm not the light. I came to bear witness and to testify. I love that. Witness and testify. I am not the light, but I am pulling the chain on the true light that is after me. Pay attention. John the baptizer was a willing witness, even to his death. So the gospel writer John continues on in this moving up to the Christmas story. Later on, the Pharisees do not recognize John for who he is, do not remember his own prophets. They do not remember the writings of their own people. They pointed a question to John the Baptist, are you Elijah? John says, well, that's a pretty good question, but that would be a no. He said, no, it's no. Murmur among themselves. I can just see it happening. Well then, who are you? What are you doing? Why are you in this place? That coat. That strange diet. What's going on? I can hear John saying, good question. I'm a voice crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord. And I could see the Pharisees going, oh yeah, right, now we get it. No, they didn't do that. They didn't like that. They didn't want to accept that. There was no way to realize that in their lives. They were not obedient observers. And oh, by the way, he might have said, hey, I'm a voice crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord. Our prophet Isaiah said that, by the way. The numbers aren't there, but it's going to eventually be chapter 40, verse 3. Just look it up when you get there. Oh, I pray that my lifelong journey would never be part of the phrases that we find in today's scripture. That I do not recognize him, and that I do not know him as my own. The words of Robert McGimsey's song just a moment ago, Sweet Little Jesus Boy, was the transparent statement that recurs all the way through that song. We didn't know who you were. It's a poignant understanding that we go through the motions, the actions, the rituals, that which makes us feel good or like we are doing good for the season, but like salt, we may lose a little flavor or preservation. Now, here's the thing. If we participate in the season, that will come and go. We participate in the Savior and never leaves. We'll never have to say, what child was that? Friends, we have a world today, after all this hustle and bustle, after all those songs that started right after Halloween, after all those things that we've been caught up in, and all the things we've been busy doing, we have a world now just wanting, because for them there's nothing left. Oh my goodness, but there is. And we carry that to a world that needs to hear. If we participate in the season, it's gone. If we participate in the Savior, it's a lasting participation. It's been so blatantly before us, has it not? This season, every season, and it's not bad. I'm not being humbugged, to make a past tense for you. I'm trying to help us move into this 2019 with some kind of feeling and understanding for those that do not have what we have right here. It's not to keep to ourselves. I wonder if there's one or two things in this season, maybe more, but hopefully at least one or two, that advanced your movement toward Christ, that helped you in your life in Christ. Anything? Remember that now? Might have been some music, might have been a sermon, it might have been just a contemplative moment by yourself somewhere, possibly gathering with friends. What was it? What was it? A time that we get beyond the gifts, the party, the feasts. Lord, I need to get beyond the feasts. The loud, the smells, the endless car commercials, the political whatevers, and what we do. What is our takeaway? What's your takeaway from the season that just passed us by? What child was that? With all apologies to Mike Cash, I think the Grinch is just a little bit misplaced. I'm sorry. I'm just going to be honest about this. We don't need to worry about a Grinch who steals Christmas before it happens, because it's going to happen. I asked my wife the other day, as we were talking about this sermon, I said, Sandy, in all the renditions that we've seen of the Grinch Who Stole Christmas, have we ever seen him steal a calendar off the wall and stick that in the bag? Has he ever, like, you know, erased 25 off of December? I haven't seen that. And it's because he can't stop it. And I think that's the amusement of the story. As hard as he tries, he cannot stop Christmas. It is the Grinch that steals Christmas after that we need to worry, we need to watch. When he steals before, it's still coming. There's nothing he can do. It's still marked on the calendar like a train that is before us. It is on the tracks and it's headed right for us, and it stops just briefly. We open all those gifts and we have all those, and then it moves on. What child was that? quickly followed by the train coming this way. Happy New Year! And we're caught in this middle with a world in darkness. And hopefully we do not utter, "What child was that?" I heard just a few nights ago someone say, and this usually doesn't bother me, but it seemed to kind of go through me that particular night. I think it was a mood I was in. But they said, "Christmas is over." I said, "What? Christmas was over? It's over?" Oh, no, wait a minute. That's not ready. I'm not ready to receive that. I'm not ready to take that on. But by the calendar, it was over. And we have a world that's out there saying, "What child was that?" Honestly, I'm glad it has moved on, the it of Christmas. I'm sure some of you are as well. And what I mean by that, I mean all those things that hide the babe in the manger and the real reason for why we do it, that distracts our attention to the postseason with 51 weeks ahead of us, the rest of time. You know, it's so symbolic that Mary and Joseph had to eventually flee with the baby to hide. You know, it's kind of like what this season is. We just kind of, where do we find Jesus in all of this? The stall goes back to normal. The manger has hay for the animals now. The ones who normally took care of things are back in the picture taking care of things. All is quiet and all is calm in a different way. And they may even say to themselves, what child was that? Who was that? Well, what I'd like for us to explore is the question, how do we keep this going? How do we keep this movement? Not to be caught up in, okay, now it's over, and what do we do now? But as people of God, we know what we do now. We know what we need to do. As we explore this coming year, while we're still feeling the warmth of the season, how do we so order our lives after this Christ child's example to be bold Christians in the new year? Are you ready for that? Being bold Christians in the new year? I think it's a great thing to do. I think it's a wonderful thing to consider. Bold Christians in 2019. It could be our mantra. I'm going to be a bold Christian in 2019. How do we do that? Well, I've heard that the big question for 2019 is why? Why? So in 2019, we're supposed to ask why. Now, that's not to be cynical and question everything, but it's to really examine our purpose. Why am I doing what am I doing? Why am I making that decision? Is it really an important thing? Why should I be here? Why now? And I think it's good for us. I think it would be good for us as Christians to do that. So let's capitalize on that a little bit. One thing I think that would help us get to the bold Christians of 2019 is to be dynamic disciples. Now, why be a dynamic disciple? John starts his passage today with light. So let me use light to give us why we should be dynamic disciples. We are light bearers to a world of darkness, we are taught today. Light is delicate and subtle and then very strong as well. And there are times we need to move between the two. The dynamic of being a disciple is understanding that. How do we understand that? Why do we understand that? Well, we understand that by what you're doing today. We come, we worship, we come to this place to learn, we come to this place to soak in what it is that God is for us, why it is God for us. We attempt to strengthen ourselves here in this place in all that we do. It's the dynamic disciple part is the soaking it up, bringing it in. Colossians 1:12 says this, giving joyful thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of His holy people in the kingdom of light. So we're gathered together here in the light to soak up the light. But it doesn't stop there. We learn of Christ. We learn of His experience. We learn of His majesty. We celebrate the seasons. But we move beyond that. We learn to pray without ceasing. We learn to recognize our place through the light. So we discern that light. How do I do that? One way to answer that question is to be thankful for those who were before you as dynamic disciples that were not stopped by that question. You are here today because there was or is and continues to be a dynamic disciple in your life. But they moved on beyond that to become a willing witness. That's number two. Dynamic disciple, willing witness, number two. John 1:5 says this, this then is the message which we have heard Him and declare to you that God is light. In Him there is no darkness at all. We are distinguished by the light. You heard a couple of, maybe about a month ago, you are ID'd by the light. You are called, in the Sermon on the Mount, you're called salt and light. Jesus recognizes you as that. A role, a position, salt and light. So to a world that's incredibly dark, it makes sense that we become willing witnesses to bear that light to all those dark corners. Now, not all of us can do all corners. We're gifted in different ways. We work within our gifts and we approve and affirm those gifts in other people. Are you a willing witness today? Are you a willing light bearer today? We've been told today through the scripture that there is darkness in this world. There's pain, there's hate, there's corruption, there's distraction, there's deception. But we move with confidence as willing witnesses to illuminate that darkness of the world. Give yourself over for 2019 to the offering of Christ. So we have dynamic disciples being willing witnesses. And this third one, I never would even have thought of being in this group, but it's something that just came very evident to me, I think, through God, that for us today, so this is for somebody, we need to become obedient observers. Never quite heard that, but I think it fits. Obedient observers. Sometimes we just do not take the time to observe in a real way. Now often, especially if like we're in a conversation with somebody, we'll be formulating in our head our next response rather than really listening and observing that particular person or group or whatever is going on. Some of the greatest ministry is before us because someone took the opportunity in a non-judgmental way to just observe. Hey, I think there needs to be a church up there on that hill. A matter of fact, I think Hill would be a great name for that church. Let's just watch and see how God moves in this situation. And here we are. The greatest pieces of ministry we have start with an obedient observation toward that ministry. It fits into being dynamic disciples, willing witnesses, obedient observers. Matthew teaches us, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. From Colossians we hear, devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. You know, it's very difficult for us to lose sight and direction when we are disciples who are willing to witness and to be obedient in our observations. I think it is observations where we find our obedience sometimes. What child was that? Well, for us who are here gathering the light to share to a world of darkness, we understand that child is the one who became and continues to be our Savior. We understand that child is the one who became and continues to be consistent in his love of the Father and therefore his love of you. What child was that? We see this as one who becomes and continues to be the one to bring us into the new year with strong relationships as his 2019 disciples. Are you ready? Are you ready? Not being so distracted that we take a step back and we blink our eyes and we say, what child was that? In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, let us pray.
This has been the worship service from Trinity on the Hill United Methodist Church, a production of Trinity Methodist Television, as an outreach ministry to those of the Augusta area. If you found this to be a meaningful service, let us hear from you by calling 738-8822 or writing Trinity on the Hill, 1330 Montesano Avenue, Augusta, Georgia, 30904.